not quite a bazillion years, but the last 10 years have seemed like a career for me. I'm going to go through some things very quickly, and we're just kind of the tip of the iceberg type comments here today. We only have a limited amount of time. It's interesting to me that while states like Nevada are, the state boards of accountancy are promulgating rules that say it's okay under the state board, there's still the Controlled Substances Act of 1970 that says you can be accused of aiding and abetting if you're involved in an illegal activity. And that's the fear that we still have, that, you know, right now that fear has been mostly set aside, but it's still there until that gets changed at the federal level. This is just a Gallup survey from about a little over a year ago. It talks about whether it's morally acceptable for people that use or don't use to drink alcohol versus smoking marijuana, and you can see how that gap is getting pretty close. Just a quick overview of where it's legal and where it isn't. Just a show of hands, if you're willing. How many people come from jurisdictions where medical cannabis is allowed? How many people are from jurisdictions where adult use or recreational use is allowed? Okay. It's changing. I was here at a presentation in Vegas a couple years ago where a keynote speaker said that this industry is like a cross between the end of prohibition and legalized gambling all at once. But the end of prohibition is happening on a state-by-state level. At some point, it's going to be dealt with at the federal level, and it'll be a watershed moment, believe me. There's a whole bunch of hot-button issues. The cannabis industry is expected to be a $20 to $30 billion industry within 2 or 3 years. To put that in perspective, the wine industry is about a $60 billion a year industry, and beer is about a $100 billion a year industry. So in a couple of years, under the current scenario, it's projected to be a third to a fifth of those two industries. So it's coming. It's there. They need professionals to support it. So I would urge all of you to go back to your jurisdictions and beat the drum a bit with your, you know, state society or with the AICPA, whoever, to say we need to, you know, kind of be able to serve these clients that are in the regulated legal side versus the illegal side. And I'll have a comment on that in a minute. The real battle lines that we see are at the municipal level and the county level. It's legal in Colorado. It has been for almost as long as any place else. I live in Golden, Colorado. Nothing allowed there. The western part of Denver is not buying it in terms of the suburbs, so you have to travel into Denver or some of the small suburbs to find it. That's happening in Michigan and in California, that there's just huge battles going on between kind of the cities and the counties in terms of whether they want to accept it. It's happening in Canada between the provinces. They've legalized it throughout the whole country, but you can't get access to it in many of the provinces because they haven't sorted out how to allow it, you know, at the local level. Internal Revenue Code Section 280E that I have a couple slides on that we can just touch on, that's the big hammer right now. You can't deduct anything other than cost of goods sold at the federal level. So those that are involved in tax compliance, you really need to understand 280E, code section 61, that defines gross income as after direct cost of producing the income. So there's a lot of need for people that understand how that works. There's a lot of operators in the industry that once they understand that, they try to play the game of pushing everything up into cost of goods sold. You can't use 263A, that, you know, where you capitalize things into cost of goods sold, because that was promulgated after the Controlled Substances Act, and you can't use a code section to convert a non-deductible expense into a deductible expense. So that's just, you need to understand those nuances if you're in the tax compliance side. James Cole, who was the author of the infamous Cole Memorandum under Attorney General Eric Holder in the Obama administration, when states like Colorado and Oregon started legalizing marijuana, they said at the Department of Justice level, we'll let you self-regulate as long as you don't cross the line on a number of issues in terms of keeping it out of the hands of kids, keeping organized crime out of it, keeping it from crossing state lines. Things that happen crossing state lines is a big issue in Colorado, just because I wish I could tell you some stories there. But James Cole spoke at a conference He's retired now, and he made a good point. It's like prohibition. It's not going away. Alcohol's not going away. So if cannabis isn't going away, there's more people using it today between the legal and illegal sides of the market than ever before. We might as well regulate it, tax it, and test it. Test it to make sure it's pure, regulate it to try to keep it out of the hands of children. You'll never be perfect. And regulate it, you know, and control it like we do alcohol. And I think he made a very good point in that. There was just a major bust in the Denver area where all the coordinated agencies busted 247 residential properties and seized 80,000 cannabis plants that were being grown. Like people are, the gray market and the black market, they're still growing it in their basement and their garage, selling it to their friends and their neighbors. And they're not allowing that to happen. So the more that happens, the more it's going to be pushed back to the regulated side of the market. And just before I forget this one thought, we're not far from Planet 13 here in Vegas, which is the largest dispensary on the planet, 40,000 square feet. And I don't think it's too far from this this hotel. I haven't had a chance to see it, but mind-boggling to think of a 40,000 square foot dispensary. I've valued dispensaries that are less than 1,000 square feet that are doing $70,000 to $80,000 a day in sales that I value for $12 to $15 million for a 1,000 square foot facility. It's mind-boggling what's going on in this profession. There's a lot that's happening in terms of CBDs and hemp and all the related things, and it's kind of a separate part of cannabis. That's emerging that also needs help and assistance. And there's the hemp industry, the regulated hemp industry, and in 2018 Farm Bill that kind of took it out from underneath the cannabis umbrella. But that's still a process that's still kind of taking hold. I think you're going to see lots of opportunity to provide service to that industry because that's expected to be a $2 to $3 billion industry. This is not just a U.S. phenomenon; it's an international phenomenon. Cannabis is being legalized and cultivated and refined throughout the world.